Hi. Sound is a weird soup, and we've got to talk about that. If you want to experience this video in its intended way, you need to wear headphones, soundbuds or IEMs, because loudspeakers can't convey the effects that you are supposed to hear. Now I'm about to play you a sound sample. It's just one note for a few seconds. A perfect sine wave. Listen carefully and tell me if you think something weird is happening. Did you hear something? If you think the loudness was changing, it wasn't. If you heard the sound moving, well, it still came out of your headphones. If you heard nothing, don't worry, you are not alone. This is an effect not everyone can hear, but before I can explain it to you, I need to tell you a story. I was discussing sound localization with a friend, and here is how it works. Welcome to the void. Around us is nothing, except air. We can't see sound, but this plane will help us to visualize it. It shows us the pressure at each location. In the middle is an ideal speaker. It pushes and pulls on the molecules around it. This was just a short pulse. Let's watch it for a little bit longer. High pressure means your eardrums are pushed into your head. Low pressure means they are pulled out. Let me stop time and introduce you to Pinman. He's just a head with two ears. Each ear hears always exactly what happens to the pressure at their position. Now, Pinman looks straight at the sound source. So, let's visualize what each ear hears. As you can see, both ears hear exactly the same thing. The envelopes of the waves tell you the loudness of the signal depending on the distance, and as you could imagine, they are both identical for both ears. But what happens if we turn his head? Now he looks towards us. His ears are in one line towards the sound source. For him, the sound will come from his right side. The wave comes and hits his right ear, and now his left ear. There are now two important factors that help Pinman localize the sound came from his right side. First, the amplitude of the wave is higher on one side, partially because the distance to the left ear is longer, but also because his head creates a so-called shadow that dampens the sound for his left ear. Secondly, the longer distance to the left ear also means the wave takes longer to get there, and therefore there's a short time delay. And usually the description ends here. But I was like, wait, there's another thing different. The phase. When we were looking at the straight sound source, the waves to left and right ear were completely identical. But now, there can be the case where we have low pressure on one ear, while we have high pressure on the other one. This means one eardrum can be pulled out, while the other is pushed inside. And when time moves on, we can see that the eardrums are never moving in the same direction. Couldn't it be possible that we can feel that? My friend didn't believe so, but I said, maybe? I'm sure I once heard something like this. So I went home and turned on my synthesizer. Let me explain to you what I programmed. This is a perfect sine wave. To keep it simple, we will neglect the loss of loudness due to distance. As you can see, a sine is periodical. This means, after it has traveled a small distance, the same curve is repeated perfectly. Because of that, mathematicians decided we can describe a sine similar to a circle. Therefore, every point on the sine wave is mapped to a point on the circle. And when we finish the circle, we finish one period of the sine wave. Like in a circle, we name each point of a period with an angle. Mathematicians are fans of pi. So they name angles multiples of that. Most other people are used to degrees though, from 0 to 360, and then again, from 0 to 360, with 0 and 360 being the same thing. In a musical context, the absolute phase of a wave is usually not that important, because even for bass frequencies, with 50 Hz, a 1 second note has still 50 full oscillations of the wave. With a second similar wave, we can describe how they are shifted to another. Let's start to move the lower wave. Now we are at 90 degrees phase shift, and now we are at 180 degrees. As you can see, at 180 degrees the waves are total opposites of each other. Therefore, this is the maximal phase shift one can achieve. If we shift further till 360 degrees, we can see that both waves are identical again. Let's take a minute and talk about the other important parameters of a sound wave. The amplitude A is affected by the wavelength lambda, which tells us the distance in space x that the wave needs to make one full oscillation. On the other hand, we have the frequency f. It tells us how many oscillations per second we make in the time domain t. And also, there is this little phi, which tells us the starting phase of our initial wave. The important part here is that the frequency and the wavelength are directly connected to the speed of sound in the given medium. In air, this is somewhere around 340 meters per second. Therefore, if we know the frequency, we know the wavelength. For example, let's take a frequency of 440 Hz. This wave has a wavelength of around 77 cm. If we double the frequency to 880 Hz, this means the wavelength will be around halved, with 39 cm. On the other hand, a halved frequency of 220 Hz means a doubled wavelength of around 155 cm. Why did I have to tell you all of this? Well, I have to be honest with you. My first example, where I showed you the wave on the left and the right ear were flipped in opposite directions, this was a little bit cherry-picked, but with good intentions. Let me show you this. This is Pinman again, with his left and his right ear. And this is the wave I showed you in the first example. We see high pressure at one ear and low pressure at the other. The wavelength I used was exactly double the distance between his ears. This means the phase difference was exactly 180 degrees, the maximum it could be. If I have just double the wavelength of that, the phase difference would have been only 90 degrees. And if I have just half of that, the wavelength would be the same as the distance between his ears, and the phase difference would have been zero. If the wavelength was half the distance between his ears, the phase difference would also be zero. And if you take any whole fraction of the distance as our wavelength, the difference in phase will always be exactly zero. But it is very important to note that these few wavelengths are also the only cases where the phase difference is zero. Every other wavelength will lead to a real phase difference. And the second you turn your head, the distance relative to the direction of propagation will change, and you have to calculate the differences in phase again. So, now we know what the phase difference is, and you will have figured by now, there is no hard rule what the phase difference will be for different directions. Every possible signal has its own phase difference for every possible direction, and the only rule of thumb is, for a bass frequency, the phase shift will be always positive, but for high frequencies with a wavelength of, let's say, 20 times smaller than your head, when you turn your head for 180 degrees, you will hear the phase shift from 0 to 360 20 times, and therefore it is pretty much impossible to reconstruct the direction of the high-pitched sound wave just by its phase. This doesn't mean that it should be impossible to hear, since the physical effect of the phase is still there. It just means the evolutionary advantage of hearing or feeling something like this would be kind of slim. And another thing is, a phase difference does pretty much never occur as a standalone effect in nature. So the interesting part is now, what happens if we eliminate the difference in loudness and the time delay? What will your brain do when it only has phase information? Now you are at the position of pinman. You will hear a perfect 220 Hz signal on both of your ears. They are perfectly in phase. We will start to shift the left ear's phase by 180 degrees. Now they are exactly out of phase. If your left eardrum is pulled, your right eardrum is pushed. You could turn the speakers to mono and would only hear my voice. Let's shift the right phase by 180 degrees to catch back up with the left phase. And we are back in phase, with both the left and right speaker playing exactly the same thing. And did you feel like the phase was doing something? I will give you the next audio sample in just a second. This time without my voice. It will be 4 times a note with 220 Hz, but every time the phase shifts by 180 degrees. Therefore, the first and third tone will be identical, as well as the second and fourth. Can you hear a difference? I was convinced I could. So I showed this to my friend, but he said they sound identical, and I was confused because I was really sure there was a difference. Then I showed it to more friends. Some were just casual boys and girls, and some were professionally trained musicians for decades. And the whole picture did get even blurrier. Some casual guys could tell exactly where a wave was flipping, and some didn't hear anything. And some of the professionally trained musicians heard it, but some also didn't. And those are guys who play for a living. Music is literally their life. And what's even funnier about this is everyone was telling me different things about what exactly they heard. Like, one guy said the sound where the phase was sweeping was moving from the front around him and stopping somewhere to his right. One guy said it was moving from side to side, and one guy said it was getting louder on his left ear when the waves were out of phase. And short reminder, the loudness was always identical on both ears. And for the phone notes example, some could hear them flip and said the sound was coming from the front and then from the sides and front and sides again. But the side thing couldn't be really specified. It was just the side. Some said it was left, some said it was right, some said it was louder, and some couldn't hear anything. I also showed them the samples with different pitches, but sadly I can't do that on YouTube because while sound compression is pretty genius here, the compression algorithm doesn't really care about phase accuracy, and I couldn't get it to work consistently. But if you want, you can go to my website in the notes down below. There are raw uncompressed files that you can listen to. And while you are already there, I decided I want to figure this phenomenon out. Who can hear it? And what do people hear? Is there an interpretation that's more common? Or is it completely random? If you have the time, you can tell me under the samples what you experience, and I will try to evaluate the responses, both here and on the website. And I will give you an update video about what you tell me. This is such a cool phenomenon, and I really hope one could use this musically. But till then, keep your ears curious, and till next time. Then I realized, damn, we are gonna have a huge placebo problem.